That is much better. We're glad you're here worshiping with us this evening. And if you will, join us as we have our call to worship. Jason, can we put that? Is it on the screen? If it's not, it's in the bulletin. Please read with me. The prophet Isaiah said, "The people who walk in darkness have seen a great light. Those who live in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shone.
O come, Emmanuel."
The priest Zechariah said before John's birth, "By the tender mercy of our God, the dawn from on high will break upon us to give light to those who sit in darkness, to guide our feet into the way of peace."
O come, Emmanuel.
The evangelist John said, "What has come into being in him was life, and the life is the light of all people. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it."
O come, Emmanuel.
God is with us. God is coming into our lives in a new way. The birth of the Christ child is the renewal of hope, a reminder that Christ will come again, and a reminder for us to keep watch for the light, for it is drawing near.
O come, Emmanuel.
Let us pray. God of light and love, shine upon us this Christmas Eve and into the year ahead. Guide us out of darkness and into your joyous light. May our lives reflect your glorious love, that others may see your Christmas spirit in us each and every day of our lives. Amen. And I invite you to stand with me as we sing our opening song, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Just want to take a moment to say welcome. We are so glad that you are here worshiping with us at Highland this Christmas Eve. We decided to go with, you know, the manger theme, you know, no room at the inn. We're packing them in, and we appreciate your adaptability and flexibility with all of that. We're pulling literally every chair we have in the place so that we have people places for everyone to sit. But we are so glad that you are here. And remember, you know, Christmas Eve is a service sort of unlike any other throughout the year. So it may be a little bit louder than some services. You might hear some talking voices. It'll be okay. Because we are so glad that you are with us. Want to ask you, if you are visiting with us, or if you think maybe we don't have your information, there are cards inside each bulletin. We would love to get that information so we can share with you what's going on throughout the year. But these kids are amazing and adorable, and I'm not going to make them wait any longer.
Yeah. can't even remember how quiet you all were when coming to the church. Was it amazing? Way to start our worship together, and as we move forward, I'm going to invite the extended Harrell family, so the two sets of Harrell families, the Howard family and the Carisiana family, come up and light our Advent wreath.
Stand and join us as we sing Hope Was Born This Night.
Glory to God in the highest. confession with gratitude, to offer up our darkness and the hope of what the prophets say comes this evening, light, which the darkness will not dispel. So let us boldly, with confidence, and full of the belief of the light that is coming to us, let us join together in the prayer of confession as printed in our bulletins. Lord,
we have lived far too long in the dark places of our own making. We have walled ourselves in, shut the world out, and held ourselves captive to our fear and failings. Free us from this place, Lord. Return us to a life in your presence, where we may face the trials of this world with you by our side. Restore your light to our eyes, that we may behold anew your love in our lives. Hear us and help us, we pray. We wait in eager anticipation for the glory of your salvation this night. Amen.
Rejoice and be glad. Your burdens are lifted. Your captivity is ended. The Lord's great light pierces the darkness, breaching the walls of our prisons, revealing the way to true freedom. Light, love, and salvation have come to us this night. Christ is born, and with Christ, we are born anew. And all of God's people said,
amen.
May the peace of Christ be with you all. Share the peace of Christ with everyone.
Hi, how are you?
Hey, what are you doing for having y'all over for dinner? Unless y'all have plans.
I do. I have to FaceTime in for Christmas at home.
Can you do that for us? So you're going there and then
back
to the Okay, God. I was going to say, like, who would you tune in for that?
No chips very well.
That doesn't matter.
But I added a little bit. It's the legend of the candy cane. you know all about it well. If I say something that's not true, don't tell them, okay? So, according to the legend of the candy cane, this candy was first created back in the 18th century. At that time, in certain areas, there was said to be a ban on public displays of Christianity. One man found this very sad and wished he could share the love of Jesus and the joy of Christmas with the rest of the world. Well, he had an awesome job. He was a candy maker. And this man prayed to find a way that he could share the joys of Christmas with all the kids around him. So his prayer led him to the idea of, drum roll please, the good old-fashioned candy cane and treats. So I do have a lot. Maybe if you listen, you get one at the end. So let me tell you about this candy cane, okay? And I know if you're like me, you probably eat about 40 of them this Christmas season. So the candy cane, the shepherd's staff. I hold it this way. It looks like the shepherd's staff. He chose to make the candy cane in the shape of a shepherd's staff. After all, Jesus is the shepherd to his followers, and the Bible notes that Jesus would hear his voice and follow him. When I flip it around, what letter does it make? J. And J stands for? There we go. Not only was the candy cane in the shape of a staff, but when held upside down, you're right, the letter J, which stood for Jesus. Next, is a candy cane hard or soft? Hard, because Jesus is a rock. The candy maker chose hard candy for the candy cane. It is very sticky. You're right. And because Jesus always sticks around, doesn't he? So, what he was done, what he did, is he reminds us that Jesus is the rock for us. He's dependable and strong. Okay, what else is on my candy cane? There are what? Stripes. And this is the one I'm sure you all know. What color? Red and white. Well, this did it.
And blue.
And blue and green and purple and any color you can think of. But I'm talking about the red and white. Why red and white stripes are on candy cane, and they represent, I do it for my necklace, and they look like Santa, but let me tell you my version of the story. Jesus shed his blood for our salvation, and the white purifies us from sin. Well, I have three more things to tell you. What does this smell like? Peppermint. Why did we choose peppermint for the candy cane? It was a flavor that the candy maker chose because think about the wise men. And it was sticky, but the wise men brought gifts to Jesus, and they were hard, but they had different smells to them, so that's why we chose the smell of peppermint. Okay, if I take this candy cane, is it broken?
No.
When I do this, if you're like me, fall on my purse, what happens?
It's not ruined.
It is not ruined, let me tell you why. It is not a staff or a chip. When a candy cane is eaten, it is often broken. Or like I did over here, you drop it and it breaks. And the candy maker did that to remind you that when Jesus was crucified, his body was broken for you. And last but not least, the candy cane is a great gift to give because the candy cane was also made to show the love that Jesus has for every single person in this world and every single person in this room. So, although no one is quite sure if the legend I told is true or if the facts that I made up are quite true, this is what I want you to remember. Are you guys ready? Everything I said was true, thanks, Ian. Thank you, I'll take that. I don't need any more facts. If you have facts, you can share with your family, because here's what I want to tell you. When you're eating Christmas dinner, share your facts. Because the beauty of the story, guys, about Christmas and your candy cane you're going to take with you is, remember that sweet baby Jesus, remember why we celebrate Christmas, and enjoy these great times with your family. The candy cane used to be just a white stick. The facts are going all night, ladies and gentlemen. So today, as you leave, I have a candy cane for you. Everybody out there, as you guys leave, the children will be waiting at the door with a special treat for you. So, Merry Christmas, enjoy your candy canes, and enjoy the special time with your family.
Bye, guys!
All right, after the children get their candy canes, they're going to be heading back.
to their families. The nursery is fully staffed tonight, but the kids are not heading out. And as we do that, I just want to reiterate that on Christmas Eve of all nights, but every night here at Highland, there is always room for all of our kids. So, you know, if you're a parent and you have a child with you, say, under the age of 21, take a deep breath. They may be loud, and it will be okay. All right? It is fine. And this is a good reminder that Jen will go to any length to get candy. And then as the children head back, we will hear our first reading for the night.
Reading from the book of Isaiah, chapter
53,
verses 2-7. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a great light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing the plunder. For in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing it and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this.
Mary did. A reading from Luke 2, verses 1 through 20. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in clothes and placed him in a manger because there was no room, no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger." Suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. And all who had heard it were amazed at what the shepherd said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
God, as we come to worship you this night, fill us with your light and love, that we may reflect your light and your love into the darkness around us. Amen. So we've gathered here together on this special night to celebrate and remember the Christmas story, and it's a story that we are all familiar with. And if you've been joining us on Sunday mornings here over the course of this December, we've been focusing on coming home for Christmas. And there was sort of a twofold idea there. One was we wanted to make sure we were extending an invitation to everyone to kind of come back home to Highland for Christmas. And so we're glad you took us up on that. We're glad you're here. But we also wanted to focus on the basics of hope and joy and love and peace. And tonight we wanted to talk about light. Christmas and the baby Jesus in the manger, they're a reminder for us, a reminder that God himself, the light of the world, has come to us. Now, for most of us, light isn't just at the heart of the story, it's also at the center of our celebrations and our traditions of this night. I think, you know, for me, and I think for many of us, it really wouldn't be Christmas Eve if there weren't candles and we didn't sing Silent Night, right? I mean, it's not Christmas Eve unless you're doing that. And I was thinking about that this week, because we're living in a time where so many of our traditions and the things that we've always done, our expectations, seem to have just gone out the window. And I was trying to think and put my finger on why that has endured, right? Why it's still important to so many of us. And I don't think it's just about tradition or nostalgia. I think there's something deeper happening as we light candles and we sing together. Right, we all know this, it is a beautiful moment. And it's beautiful in part, I think, because it happens in the dark. Right? And as we've talked this December about hope and joy and peace and love, one of the things that we've made it a point to do is note that everything isn't always perfect. That there are lots of things going wrong in our lives and in the world. And another way to say that is, there is a lot of darkness in this world. There is a lot of darkness in our lives. So that little candle, right? That little candle we're going to hold in the palm of our hands, the light, the little light that we will hold and we will share. I think it means so much to us because it's a promise. And it's a pledge, and it is an act of defiance against the darkness that can surround us. It's, in a way, that light that we hold is a parable of a faithful life of resistance to evil and of the overcoming power of the light of God's love. And, you know, there is power and beauty and wonder in the passing of that light. It'll be just, you know, we'll take it from here and we'll move on, and pretty soon it will be spread around. And there's a physical part to that, and yet it is somehow transcendent. A reminder that no darkness can overcome the light and the love that came down to us at Christmas. It came down to us in Jesus Christ. J.R. Tolkien, speaking through Gandalf in the Lord of the Rings story, said it well this way. He says that Saruman, the bad guy in those stories, if you're not familiar, he believes it is only great power that can hold evil in check. But that is not what I have found. I have found it is the small, everyday deeds of ordinary folk that keep the darkness at bay. Small acts of kindness and love. A light in the darkness. A light in the darkness. And I think that's why the candles and silent nights still matter to us, and I think that's why we're all here. I think it's why we come to church on this or any other day. Aren't we coming here with a hope? And for some of us, that hope might be quite faint. That we just might feel and experience God's presence tonight. And I think we're coming to be reminded that in the darkness of the night and in the darkness of our lives, that we aren't alone. And that the God that joins us brings a light that can't be extinguished. And that is the message that we are coming to celebrate and to share this night, that the light of the world has come. And because the light has come, we are never alone. Henry Wadsworth Longfellow is one of my favorite poets, and not coincidentally, one of his poems provides the lyrics for one of my favorite Christmas carols, which is "I Heard the Bells on Christmas Day." Some of you know that. And some of you may know the story behind the poem and the song. He wrote the poem on Christmas morning in 1863. And the full poem and the carol speaks to the reality of the darkness in our world. And most importantly, it speaks to the power of light and love to overcome it. Wadsworth, his first wife had died in 1835. He remarried in 1843. And by all accounts, he was incredibly devoted to his second wife. She was the love of his life. But she died in a house fire in 1961. And then less than 2 years later, March of 1863, his son left to join the Union Army without his father's permission or knowledge. And in fact, Wadsworth only was informed of his son's choice when he received a letter that his son had sent after he had joined up. So then, in November of 1863, the Battle of New Hope Church in Virginia, his son, Wadsworth's son, Charles, was severely wounded, and his war was over. And now, Charles would eventually recover, but that was not at all clear. In fact, it looked like things were going to go the other way on Christmas morning in 1863.
So with the country literally tearing itself apart with war, with Wadsworth bearing so much personal loss, he woke up on Christmas Day and wrote these words. I heard the bells on Christmas Day their old familiar carols play. And wild and sweet the words repeat of peace on earth and goodwill to men. The cannon thundered in the south, and with the sound of the carols drowned of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And in despair I bowed my head, there is no peace on earth, I said. For hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. Once I knew the story behind that poem, I could never hear that song the same way, right? The depth of loss that went into those words, and it, you know, it almost gets me just about every time I hear it, and I always have to stop and pause. Because we all know there is sorrow, and there is often good cause to be sad, even at Christmas. But if you know that carol well or the poem, you know that Longfellow doesn't end the poem there. He continues, then pealed the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail, with peace on earth, goodwill to men. This is the good news for all of us this and every night. God is not dead, nor does he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail, with peace on earth, goodwill to men. Friends, the light of the world has come down into the darkness this night. The darkness of the world and the darkness of our very lives. And God has brought the light of his perfect love to you and for me and for us all. God invites us not just to receive the light, but to follow the light, to step out of the shadows of this world and allow his light to shine on all of our hearts and in and through all of our lives. We light a candle and we pass it. But we, God, invites us to take that light with us as we leave. The light of the world is shining on us. And God, Emmanuel, God with us, is calling us to let his light shine in us and through us. Joy to the world, the light has come. Let us go out into the world, traveling together, bringing and sharing the light that no darkness can ever overcome. Amen. And so now, on Christmas, we come to this table, which is not Highlands table or a Presbyterian table, but it is the Lord's table, and we come to be reminded of why Christ came. Christ came for his love for us. Christ came to live for us and, in fact, to die for us so that each of us might be reconciled to God, filled with the light and the love of God, and invited to be co-workers with God in the mission of the world, going out, spreading the light and love with all that need it into every dark corner of the world. It was so that God's light might shine in this place and, in fact, in every place, that on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And after giving thanks for it, he broke it. And he handed it to his disciples, and he said to them, take, eat, this is my body, and has been broken for you.
And after they supped that night, he took the cup, and showing it to them, he said, this cup is the new covenant, filled with my blood shed for the forgiveness of all sin. Take, drink, do so in remembrance of me, knowing every time you eat of this bread and you drink of this cup, you do so fulfilling the promise that Christ is coming. And until then, let us wait for his light. We invite those that are assisting with communion to come forward at this time because, sisters and brothers, the table is set and all of God's children are invited.
And a little bit of logistics. There'll be two stations here at the front, two stations at the back. So we'll start from the front and the back. So the last row will get up and go to the back. The first row will come and come to the front. And then you'll follow your row as it moves through. If you are gluten-free, we have that, and that is at the front. So if you need to receive a gluten-free bread, come to the front. All right? Come. Receive the gifts of God for all the people.
Led by the light of
are so grateful, so excited, so changed by the love that God has shown us in the gift of Jesus Christ, that we simply can't walk away from here without responding. The same God who chose to come to earth as a tiny baby invites us to shine the light of love into the world. Through our gifts this night, we have an opportunity to say thank you, to say yes to life and salvation, to say glory to God in the highest heaven. So sisters and brothers, let us give of our tithes and offerings. Gift of your Son. Through your grace, you have given us everything. including our very lives. On this night, we celebrate the miracle of Christmas. And when the candles are blown out, when the ringing of the bells has ceased, when the angels and shepherds have gone home, may we continue to shine your light into the world through the giving of these offerings. And so we offer you yet another gift, our partnership to build your reign here on earth. Amen.
Thank you.
Arise, shine, dear people, for our light has come.
Christ is the world's true light on our paths and in our lives.
Receive the light, and let its warmth and glow be in your heart this night.
The glory of the Lord shines around us on this night.
As we go out into this soon-to-be night, remember that you don't ever go alone. Christmas means that Emmanuel, God, is with us. So God goes with you wherever you go, and God invites you to follow the light of his love, and take that light and that love with you into all the dark corners of the world. Go in peace, the love and serve the Lord. Let's stand as we sing our closing song, Joy to the Lord.